Okay, hello friends. So today Dilip is with us and he's going to share his journey, how he's able to crack visa interview. And friends, believe me, this interview is pretty difficult because here we don't have one or two rounds. We have multiple, I think around five rounds he has given in order to secure this particular position as a Scrum Master. So we will definitely going to go through all the common questions which are asked in all these five interviews. So definitely you can benefit out of it. So before we start, friends, if you are new to our channel, please subscribe. You can watch other videos over here, different sessions which we have done with various Scrum Masters in the past. So please subscribe. And if you find any value out of this session, please give a big thumbs up. Your one like is a big motivation for us. So thanks everyone. And welcome, Dilip, and thanks for your time, Dilip.
Thank you, Sanan. Thanks for your time, for inviting me to the session. I'm very grateful for inviting me to the session. I've been inspired by you, all your videos, your thoughts, your whatever you have shared with us. And all those videos have really helped me to clear out those interviews and get me a better job and an opportunity. Thanks for that.
Okay. Thank you, Dilip, for that. Okay. So, very first question is, tell us about your journey as a Scrum Master, how you started and how you do the transition and all those things.
Sure, Sunanda, I'll tell that. So, when I started my journey as a Scrum Master, I was working as an QA person. So when the transformation of Agile happened in a project where I was earlier working, they had a request coming from the client side to say to move all the teams into an Agile model, and they wanted somebody to take up a role of a Scrum Master and the other team members to be a part of the development team. So what the organization did was they put us into a training and they transformed us into an Agile team where the PO was with us from the client side, but the Scrum Master and the development team was from the organization side. So that is how I started my journey as a Scrum Master, and we started the journey into the Agile Scrum.
Okay, thanks for that, Dilip. Okay, so could you please explain about your role and responsibility as a Scrum Master, which you are doing in your current project?
Sure, Sunil. So the roles and responsibilities, I would say, like we used to have I used to facilitate the Scrum ceremonies, when we are doing and as a part of our individual teams, I was doing that. And as a part of the SAFe model, I was part of taking care of the PI planning with my team members. And the other things which I used to take care of was on the providing the insights about where the team is, on how they are doing it up, removing the impediments and helping the team members to increase their productivity. So these are a few things which I was doing for my team members. And other things for the organization side was like doing audit, internal audit, like quality audits, the ISO audits and all, because we got we were helping the organization that perspective as well. So these are the fields, roles and responsibility which I was playing as a Scrum Master in the organization.
Okay, and what are the different challenges which you faced during your Agile transformation, if you want to share with us?
Sure, Sunan. So when I started my journey as a Scrum Master, the challenges, major challenges was when mindset, changing the mindset of the team, because they were working in a longer interval. The team didn't have much idea about each value of the Scrum ceremonies. So as a Scrum Master, I had to tell them the being a part of the ceremonies, what each ceremony adds a value to this, the whole Scrum processes. And the major challenge was what our team was facing was on the estimation. So when we were doing the estimation, the team was still thinking in the perspective of how many hours it is going to take. They were not calculating the dependencies. They are not taking up the risk what each item is going to bring. So these were a few things which the team learned over the period of time, about like 6-7 months it took for the team to understand that. And then they got settled at a particular point to say that, okay, this is a three-pointer, this is a five-pointer. So that was the major challenge in my transformation, and the challenges what the team had.
Okay, okay. And if you can also throw some light on user story estimation, how your team is going to do that?
Okay, so earlier when we started up, we didn't have any idea. I mean, it was all like it was completely blank for us. The team didn't understand much, and we too didn't have much experience as a project where we know how the estimation has to be done. So we were just going on blankly saying that, okay, this has this number of acceptance criteria on that. Okay, this is going to take this much amount of effort. We'll just give it as 5, 8, and whatever it comes to, that whatever the team feels, everybody accepts that and we go by that. Later, we realized that we are not considering all the complexity. Not only the complexity has been taken care of, also the risk and dependencies, which the team understood only after they started to work on few user stories. Then they know that, okay, it is not only we people are dependent to complete this user story. We have to go to the product owner or to the other teams to get the data, then only different vendors as well, since we were working with different partners in the organization. So we had to get those data from them, then only we can get this completed within the sprint. So we were using the planning poker for doing it. And slowly when we got to a point where we understood, okay, what is in one pointer and all, then we took it as a reference story, so that whenever any new team member joins in an organization or team joins in a team, what we do is we give a reference to this guy when we do the internal training for the guy to say that, okay, this is a one pointer and this is this is where you can reference it to when you're thinking about giving an estimation for a particular user story. So that is how we used to do a estimation.
Okay. And then this conflict is a very important part in any Scrum team. So how are you going to handle different conflict? And if you want to share any of your previous example, that will be also great.
Sure, Sunil. So conflict, if I say when I started my journey, it was very, very easy, I would say, because already the team I was working up, they were working with me in the waterfall for past 2.5 years. So the conflicts was very less, and when the conflict started to arise, when we went into a mode of agile, we could see that, okay, the team, there were coming conflicts among on the estimation, the team had the team started to have this kind of shaky things coming up in their way. So what I used to do is, every Monday when we start the week, whatever may be the day, whatever may be the sprint day, we used to have like first, like 9 to or 10 to 11, we used to have a rapport building session kind of thing. So what we do is, every team member on a round robin, they have to bring some games to the table to say that, okay, this week this person will do. Slowly with this team building activities, the conflict itself was gone. I mean, nobody was bringing up any conflict. If there was any issues, they themselves go and sort it out. They never used to bring it to my plate to say that, okay, Dilip, I have a problem with this guy and help me in resolving that. They themselves, once you build that rapport, once you give that openness to all the team members, they themselves will find a way to resolve that. So that is where one of the main characters of good Scrum Master. So that was one thing which when the transformation happened, the conflict was resolved. The other scenario which I'd like to explain is where the team both the guys were seniors. So one guy used to bring an issue, the other guy used to conflict that, saying that no, this is wrong what you're saying. So what I had to do is, they had to go and talk to them in one-to-one and say this, guys, I know that you both are experienced. I don't know much about this product, but even if the sound comes up only when you clap with both your hands. So single hand can't give you a sound, right? So I gave them with some examples and they told, if you guys work properly or join your hands together and work it up, we will get maximum benefit of it. So then they told, okay, let us talk about that. They went in talking into the mode and then they were able to resolve that specifically. And then there was no intervention from my side. So that was a smooth flow how I was able to resolve that.
Okay, thanks for that. Okay, and how do you give constructive feedback to your team members?
For giving the feedbacks, I used to have this kind of a model which I learned during my journey, which we call it as an SBI model. So situation behavioral impact model. So I used to be an observer whenever I used to facilitate the ceremony. So that is also one of the qualities of a good Scrum Master that we used to do. So what we do is whenever there is something what we observe and we see that, okay, this person tries to compress the other person or tries to play upon the psychological safety of this other person, I go to this person and say that I start with this kind of conversation where I say that, see, Mr. X, I want to have some kind of a conversation. If you're okay, let me start it up. Otherwise, let's not deal with that. But most of the time, whenever I ask this question to whom I wanted to give a constructive feedback or a positive one, they went and said, okay, Dilip, it's for a good thing. Let's do that. So what we used to do is then I'll explain them the situation where I observe this observe the behavior, and this I put them the situation. Then the behavior what I observe from this. I used to give the exact time, date, the is it a ceremony or what, whatever the meeting it is. I give those details. Then what behavior did I observe? Was it an harsh or you were tough on words, the selection of your words were incorrect. So these were a few things which I used to bring out to that plate. So then I say that, okay, because of this, you know what impact it has brought, that these people, this particular guy got demotivated, the morale of the team got down, and he himself thought, okay, I'll not speak about it later. I'll just be a calm guy in the team. So do you want to have this kind of culture? Then this guy understands, if that was something which I didn't notice that, but thanks for bringing that up. And he himself says, okay, let me talk to this guy and say, okay, no, that, my intention of talking that was not in this manner. As a team, we want to work it up. Let me go and I accept that was not my mistake. And he goes and talks to the team member to resolve it up.
Okay. Thanks for that, Dilip. Okay. So could you also tell some good agile practices which you brought in your team?
Yeah. So one good practice what I will tell is about the automation. So we, as a first team when I was working as a Scrum Master, so earlier what we used to do is we used to have that manual testing throughout the sprint. So we were we have to complete some kind of the test cases for that particular user stories, as well as we have to run some amount of regression test cases for that particular user stories what we are delivering, because it should not be impacting the earlier behavior which we are delivering to the customers. So that what the team used to do is they were executing it at the end of this sprint, Wednesday till Friday, they will be doing all the regression thing. So what I suggested by looking into the other teams in my project was they were starting to follow the automation. So what I suggested to our team members is, why can't we, because there was a guy who was learning automation. He was getting trained. He was going to the center for getting it trained. I told let us try. First, then based upon what we achieve during our sprint or whatever we spend whatever we analyze and get it up, we'll showcase with our product owner and get his consensus. So since product owner was some kind of person like a stakeholders from a stakeholder point, we built up like 5 basic scenarios from the team. So they automated it and they brought it to the table and said that they demoed it to the PO, saying that these 5 scenarios going forward will not be done manually, which was taking this amount of time. And this is going to reduce our execution period. So then after the presentation, the PO himself was very happy with that, what we had done. Then what the PO did was he went to his managers or his leadership team, spoke that, okay, these guys have done this. Can we get a budget to do this? Do an automation into this. Then we got budget and it in turn brought business into the project as well as to the organization. And the team finally used to complete all the regression test cases into an automation module, and they were able to success it. And they were able to give better results than earlier. So that is something which I brought it into my team.
Okay, thanks for that, Dilip. Okay. So tell us about why any organization should go for Scale Agile framework. What are the advantages of using SAFe?
Okay, so whenever the use of the SAFe model, I would say like when the organization is building up an complex a product or a package of functionalities, it cannot be built up by one or two teams working parallelly or simultaneously. But since the organization vision and the roadmap will require a lot of support from a lot of team members, so that had to be built by a bunch of people who know about the application and they have the different expertise in that. So what the SAFe does is bringing up multiple individual teams into one model to say provide up to a solution, providing a solution to a complex application. So this was something which I was asking up to to my organization when they started to follow the SAFe. So they said, okay, we are building up a product which will help our customers to build up. We want to mix up all this functionality which has 4 different applications into a single product. So that is why we are going into a SAFe mode.
Okay, thanks for that, Dilip. Okay, so what are the different prioritization technique or methods which you are aware about, and what technique which you used in your project normally?
So the different prioritization techniques which I know about is like on the first thing is on the Moscow technique, which we normally call must have, could have, should have, won't have, that one. And then a Kanon model, and there is few other techniques which are there in the market to prioritize your product backlog. The technique what we used to do in following our organization for product backlog prioritization is the Moscow technique, where during our product backlog refinement session, the product owner lists all the user stories inside that product backlog, and those items have been labeled as MO or CO or must have, could have, or should have, or won't have item. On basis of that will be prioritized, and that in turn helps the team to build up the most valuable items and help provide us to deliver values at the end of each sprint. So this is about the prioritization techniques.
Okay, what if all the user stories are must have? So in that situation, how you are going to prioritize your work?
Yeah, sure. So when we earlier start the project, we will see that okay, like if there are like 10 user stories, out of that, like there could be 5 items which are of the list of must have. So in that, we'll talk to the product owner to say that okay, these 5 are must have. can we open each of the user story and understand how detailedly this user story has given to the team so that the team can pick it up easily and can cover it up or complete it within the sprint. On that perspective, we used to have this invest criteria to check up our user stories and see that, okay, if the user story, whatever it is written in the format of which are being marked as must have, does that meet this criteria? The independent, the estimatable, the small, testable. So these all things have been matched up with that particular user story, which has got the more detailedly. So we use that particular, based upon the using the invest criteria, we will be able to pick up the first three items and to work on a particular sprint. So that is how we used to do in the for all the item which has got like multiple must-have items.
Okay, and what is a good way of writing a user story, and how are you going to split the user story?
So writing a good way is as from as when the situation, based upon the situation, how the product owner feels it from. But the better way how we as a team felt was, the since we are building up an app, so the team thought that, I mean, the product owner thought it is always to write and good to write a user story. From a user's perspective. So the way what we used to follow, or the team used to follow, or the product owner used to follow, was from a user's perspective, what he was writing all the user stories. And the user story should have all those acceptance criteria, that it should follow the invest criteria and all. And the splitting of the user stories, if what we used to do is on the basis of if it is an platform-based, if it is an Android one, as an iOS one, if it is an web-based, what are browsers, we have to cover it up. So that is how we used to split it up after checking it with the PO during our product backlog session. And so with that help of it, and we check whether how soon this item has to be delivered to the customer. Because the customers who are expecting of the iOS build has to be worked up within the sprint. The Android can be taken up later, so that items we mark it and put it in the next. So that's how we used to combine the stories, user story for a particular sprint.
Okay, thanks for that. And what are the different retro techniques which we have used so far, or which one is your favorite? If you want to explain that.
Sure, Sunan. So the retro technique is what I used to do with my team was the very simple one. What went well? What couldn't? What are the accidents of it? That was the maximum time of it I had used it. So the other techniques which I have been aware of or brought it up newly or introduced it to the team, new team members, was like the sail boat one, where asking the team members to add their cards into the what was stopping them, like it's an anchor out there, what is the wind. So this itself gave them a different perspective to that, saying that, okay, we can think it from this way as well. Okay, what are our blockers, what is the goal, what was the sprint goal, whether we were getting pushed by something, whether there was some rocks, but there was a corals inside it, which was stopping us from getting into reaching our sprint goals. So this technique, which was also I was using, and another technique which I'm aware of but not used is Mad Satellite, the flap model, and all. So these are few techniques which I used to have.
Okay, and what are the different matrices which you have used so far in your projects? Yeah.
Metrics for the team level ones, what we used to have is the normal burn down, burn up charts, the sprint report, the velocity reports, and all, what we used to get it from Jira. And when we and also the predictability metrics, which predictability ratio, what we used to calculate. Say, for example, the team picks up 10 user stories, how many of them were completed 100% on the basis of definition of time. So these are a few things which used to be used as a part of our team level one. When we go on to the PI one, we used to have other metrics on the how much PI objectives were completed, how was the predictability. So these are a few metrics which the organization itself had it for tracking the sprint, the team's progress. So this is all what I was using as a part of the metrics for our team as well as for then presenting it to the leadership.
Okay, thanks for that. And how you keep your team motivated all the time? And there are some ups and downs in the team. So how you are going to motivate your team members?
Yeah, so this is something when we went into this COVID situation, it was very difficult to have this team building activities. We couldn't do it going into a place where we go for a team lunch or we go for a fun activity or some kind of thing. So I learned about agile games. So this is something very, very new, which I learned during this COVID times. Thanks for the COVID virus. So there were a few things which I use it for the team collaboration and team building, where the team feels okay, they're not doing only the job of building, completing the user stories on time. They feel like, okay, how better we can do, or how better we can build a rapport with that. So I'll tell some example of one example what I use in a team. Was on the bubble game. So that was where I used to have that image which will have bubbles and dots inside it. So the teams has to find it. That will be three rounds of it, where each round will be for 4 minutes, 1 minute for planning, the 3 minutes for taking out the dots from that. And it was interesting. It's like they have to pick up they have the restriction of taking out only two bubbles, three dots and all at a round. So this itself put them into a team building activity where they say that, okay, no, this doesn't give them the clarity of if you remove this dot. So virtually when they're doing it up, they were talking out something which was out of the topic, the knowledge what they used to do it in the product backlog or the other ceremonies what we do. So that itself brought the team members into an kind of insertion in an area where they could talk about or they could play around it. So that's something which I tried it and really it helped it. And the team was much happy about it. They said they bring more teams, the more more games like this, so that we are happy that what we are doing. But these kinds of things which really relieves us from what we're doing it when we are doing it on the virtual world. So that something which I was happy of doing it up.
Yeah, that's good, Dilip. Great. Okay, so apart from your normal Scrum events or is there anything else apart from your team Scrum events or which you are joining outside your team?
Yes. So when I was a part of this SAFe framework, what all the things what we used to have is we used to have weekly once the Scrum of Scrums where the team members used to talk. All the Scrum Masters used from the different teams, since we had 10 teams in an organization, all the Scrum Masters will come up. We will talk about the challenges, how we, the different techniques or whatever we are using it, the best practices, what we need to improve overall, and what are the dependencies what we got in between two different team members. If it is a technical one, we used to also bring the technical tech leads with us onto that scrum to say that, okay, what technical challenge is that? What has to be resolved from this team one so that it can block this team six? So these are all things which we used to discuss in the Scrum of Scrums. Another thing which we used to have this is on the the whole organization level artsing meetings where we talk about what we have completed till now, what were the challenges, what were the dependencies, what the team has found the risk into that. So these are a few things what I used to be a part of that. And apart from that, we used to have the PI planning, pre-planning meeting with our RTE to understand what is our requirement, what needs to be done, and what needs to be done from each team side. So these are a few meetings or ceremonies which I was attending out of my team activities.
Okay, thanks for that, Dilip. Okay, and what do you do yourself as a Scrum Master to update it yourself with this fast-changing agile world? You know, there are a lot of changes happening. New things are coming every day. So what do you do yourself for yourself?
Yes, so for that, I mean, I think Career Stock is one of my favorite, I would say, top of the list. So every Scrum Master, for sure, whoever it is experienced or fresher, I would suggest first hit on the subscribe button, hit the bell icon every day and night, you'll get this notifications and you'll get to know, learn about multiple things, what I couldn't learn when before. I didn't know how could I miss this career talk earlier, how we are doing it up. Since the different Scrum Master from different part of the world, they used to share their experiences. So I would say career talk will be in my top of the list whenever, even I grow up in my ladder, I will surely keep on doing the same. And other things is on the LinkedIn. So LinkedIn used to get a lot of posts coming up from agile coaches, the RTs, the enterprise coaches and all. So that read through that, that itself will give you an insight about what is changing up and what are the different good practices, what is coming up in the market, which you could try it up, because unless until you don't try it, you don't know whether we'll fail it or say will not will succeed or not. So that way I'll say that, okay, implementing something into your team or in organization, try it with your talk it about with your leadership. Unless and until you don't get these ideas, you won't be able to talk that. So for gathering that, as much as what you get it from your peers, talk to them. And most of the times I go for at least once yearly certification to understand what kind of different Scrum Masters or the different Agile coaches, what they've got for us for learning. So this is how I keep me updated in this Agile world, fast moving Agile world.
Okay, that's good. And recently, did you read any books about Agile or anything per se? Not forget about Agile. Any books which you are reading right now?
I started this habit of doing it during this COVID times only because our time was reduced, so we couldn't get along with we couldn't go out much. So I thought to get used to with this book reading book part. So I started with a leadership book by a captain, what is his name? I just forgot him. So this was on one of a leadership book where how we can give the authority or delegate the authorities to the team members or the subordinates, so that you are even if you're not there, how the team could manage the decision. So this is something as a Scrum Master, it helped me to say that, okay, how and self-organizing teams could be made. So what I did with that was in turn I brought it into this team to say that, okay, team, say these are the few activities which still I'm taking a decision, or this decision has been taken by your project manager. So do you want to have a say, or how better can be improved? So we created a matrix out of it, and that matrix we were using it for delegating purpose. So that's something this book had brought me to do this kinds of thing. So that's something which I read it.
Okay, thanks for that, Dilip. Yeah, I think we are done with all the questions for today, Dilip. So again, thanks again for your time and sharing your wealth of knowledge, your experience with us. So thanks a lot, Dilip.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sunan. Thanks for that. Keep maintaining this. And again and again, I'm saying the same word. Sorry for that. All the Samasis out there and Ajay coaches, please do subscribe for Careers Talk. This is very, very must for your career as well as wherever you go on. Keep listening to what Sunan's talks gives you.
Thanks. Thanks for a great advertisement, Dilip. Thanks for that. So yeah, with this note, thanks everyone and bye. Have a nice long weekend. So thank you. Bye.